be within 25 miles of my grandpa Rupert's home. So after a little searching, riding home and stuff, I found out that I was just nearby to the home. So I went down, and finally, I was reading a letter from home. And as a Jewish boy, they still made Sam Rubenstein as his name. He said, let's go down and look for that little village at your grandfather's home. And he said, I speak the language. And he said, I go, and he was from New York. And he said, I go with you. So I said, Sam, how do you know the German language? He said, I was born in Poland. When the Germans invaded Poland, they took all our families. My mother died in the concentration camp. My father survived the concentration camp. My little sister and I were sent on a cattle car across Europe over into Frankfurt, Germany. And that's where we stayed until the Americans liberated Germany. And afterward, his name was Rubenstein. So after the war, the Rubenstein family, Helena Rubenstein, was a millionaire in cosmetics. Helena Rubenstein sent a group to Europe to look for these Rubenstein orphans. And they found Sam and his little sister, and they brought them to America. So later on, then, through the Jewish Federation, Sam found that his father was still with alive in Israel. And so all of us got together to send on for our peace and sent Sam to Israel to find his father. And he was older than I came. And he was so pleased that. But he was. And so Sam said, I'll go with you now, look for your family in here in Germany since you're nearby. And so we went by train down to a little village. And when we arrived at this little train station, I had a little card from my mother and my aunt Rosie. My grandpa and his brother had come to America in 1900, but they never got back. But I understood that they still had family in Germany. And the grandpa still had a younger brother that he thought was still living in Germany. They said, man, you can find him. So Sam said, well, I'm going with you. And then we went down by train to this little village called Blumenthal, a colorful valley, beautiful valley, and near the French border. And when we got there at the train station, people had a little card from Aunt Rosie that said, Aunt Rosie had said, these are some of the names and some of the relatives in Germany. We think Grandpa's youngest brother is still living, and maybe some of their cousins. And you can find them. So when we got to this little village, Sam and I, people, a few Americans, they said, this is after the war, they didn't want to speak to us. So I said, is there any chance he's not going to these things? And even the ticket taker shut his window on us. Finally, we were just ready to leave, and he came out after we sat there for a long time in the afternoon. The ticket taker came out and said, I'll sell your tickets, go back to camp. Get out of here. We don't need you here. To Americans. And just that time, a little girl came up to me and pulled on my shirt sleeve and pointed to my card from Aunt Rosie. She said, you seen him? In other words, I know these people. Follow me. So she was a bicycle, a little girl. They took the little train station up through the town, past the church, and she pointed down and to a house. Well, actually, we found out that she was a relation. That's why she was bold enough to send us to this house up past the church. And so we knocked on the door, and here comes this gentleman with one arm missing. And of course, Grandpa had told that his youngest brother, during World War I, had lost an arm. So I said, Sam, that's my Uncle Frank. That's my grandpa's brother Frank. And he said, my father spoke, what do you want here? What are you, two Americans? And then we said, don't you understand? Like, he's provided in relation. Bring him up. So, finally, he understood, here's my friend, my brother's grandson, after 57 years, gave up on my house. And he just stood there with tears in his eyes. Finally, he took us all up to the living room and then wrote on a shoebox for pictures. And they're still a little skeptical because I had this Jewish boy with me, you know, and after the war, you know, they're still skeptical. And then, they showed pictures and I said, oh, that's Vincent, this is Rosie, this is my mom. And they, later they said, well, what convinced them that I was related? Yes. All at once I said, my mother, $3 million. And then the whole thing, they had a 50-year-old picture of my mother's first communion picture. and they said, afterwards, they said, I was so excited that I had a new relation. So then, they were so excited, talking so fast that either Sam, who could speak from German, and I, we couldn't keep up. So they ran downtown to the family meat market and got Mr. Holmfeller. As he came in, he says, hello. He says, I speak to the English, I see you Americans. I said, oh, thanks, Devin. He said, I broke my dog. And it was thank Devin. He said, yes, I was in America young, but I had to come back to Germany when my father got ill to take care of the butcher meat market. And he said, then the war broke out, and I wanted to take my family back to America. I loved America when I was there and learned English. But he said, it wouldn't leave me out. So here I am, still here, 35 years later. And then he said, well, you have to meet my family. You know, and we went to meet his family, and he took his family and I, after the Lord and I, into the house, and into the living room, and been an elegant lot. And here comes this pretty young daughter, and I'm in that tray with a torque, a little ring, and a toast, and all that. Well, that was my wife, but 2 years later, I married her. That was her daughter. It's been a long time, and